In the moving, sometimes lyric epic, the hero of the poem, Väinämöinen, pauses for a moment in the narrative to recount the creation of Otso, the bear. Otso was not born in straw bed, nor was born on chaff in malt house. There was Otso brought to being, there was born the honey pod one, near the moon in the gleams of sunshine, and upon the great bear's shoulders, there besides the air's fair maiden, near the daughter of creation. The fair maiden then casts a piece of wool from the heavens into the waters below, which the winds gently flow to the forest's edge. There, Mieliki, the forest's mistress, places the soft wool into a maple basket and hangs it on a golden chain from a branch of a fir tree. Then she rocked the charming object, and she rocked the lovely creature, underneath a spreading fir tree, underneath a blooming pine tree. Thus it was the bear was nurtured, and the furry beast was fostered, there beside a bush of honey, in a forest dripping honey. And the Finnish bear grew up most handsome and attained his perfect stature. This is a portion of the Kalevala that is replicated in this book, today's book, The Sacred Paw, The Bear in Nature, Myth, and Literature. My name is Wild Stag, and thank you for tuning in to another used book rant. Today, as I said, I'm covering The Sacred Paw. This book was published in 1985, the Arcana Books version in 1992, which this one is. This is a book about bears and really looking at them through a broad lens. So the introduction discusses the bear itself, and it starts thus. From time far older than memory, the bear has been a special being, human-like, yet close to the animals and hence to the source of life. Like us, the bear stands upright on the soles of his feet, his eyes nearly in a frontal plane. The bear moves his forelimbs freely in their shoulder sockets, sits on his tail end, one leg folded, like an adolescent slouched at the table, worries with moans and sighs, courts with demonstrable affection, produces excrement similar to man's, snores in his sleep, spanks his children, is avid for sweets, and has a moody, gruff, and morose side. The bear is himself a creature in his own right, needing no justifying or compliance with human purpose. He is a kind of ideogram of man in the wilderness, as though telling of what we were and perhaps what we have lost. Wily, smart, strong, fast, agile, independent in ways that we humans left behind when we took up residence in the city. The bear symbolized the harmony of society and nature, a harmony disrupted in the modern world, in a philosophical lurch separating man from his natural origins. The chapters of this book are separated thus. The first chapter, That Ursine Quality. The second, The Kinds of Bears. The third, Celebrations of the Slain Bear. The fourth, Other Ceremonies of the Bear. The fifth, The Getic and Greek Connection. The sixth, The Literary Bear. And seven, The Beginnings. There's also an epilogue, The Past and Future of Bears, and the afterword, Fear of Bears by Gary Snyder. This book is, like I said, it takes a wide lens, a broad look at what the bear is and what it means to humans, especially European humans, who seem to be the most affected by bears in their cultures. Really, the Southern Hemisphere doesn't really have bears. At least south of the Sahara, there are no bears in human history. In South America, bears are uncommon and are not the large, powerful creatures that they are in other parts of the world. So really, what this book focuses on is the parts of the world that were affected by the brown and black bear in their history. It doesn't take too much of a look at the Asian side of things. It doesn't take a look at all at the African or the South American side of things. So that is a limitation of this book. It does describe the giant panda in the first chapter, but, or rather, it describes the great panda in the second chapter when it describes bears in general. But the cultural side of things really focuses on the European and American mindset, and including the Native American voice. There's a lot of citations of Canadian and American indigenous history here. However, when I say it mentions and discusses the Native Americans, do understand that that is through the explanations through the lens of European archaeologists and anthropologists. So there is not necessarily the most accurate description of their role in their cultures. So, for example, the spirit of the bear was addressed by the people at various times during the hunt and the funerary rites. It was usually hailed as a respected kinsman, grandfather, or grandmother. The bear was petitioned to allow itself to be killed or to die of its own choice, and later not to be angry with the hunters who deny responsibility for its death. The Asiatic Eskimos not only used synonyms for the animal itself, they would get hold of or reach the bear instead of killing it. According to their ideas, this says the Soviet ethnographer G.A. Menovshikov, the game was not killed, it came spontaneously to the man as a guest. This guest, however, had to be brought down with the help of a harpoon or spear. The killed game was highly praised and persuaded not to be offended, but to return again to the hunter. I have some friends who are Navajo, they are Diné, and they refer to the black bears in their region as grandfathers. Grandfather being a respectful term applied to other animals as well, including horny toads. Page 88 and 89 have a sidebar, well, more of a top bar, that says some synonyms for the bear. And it uses euphemisms master of the forest in Lap, Lightfoot in Finn, little mother of honey in Finn, sacred man, sacred virgin in Lap, worthy old man in Ural Altaic, honey paw in Tungus, forest apple in Finn. Big hairy one in Blackfoot, blue tooth in Lap, chief's son in Cree, the animal in Michikamen, and a lot of other ones. It is very honored in a lot of those euphemisms. It also discusses the mythological realm of the bears, so to speak, how bears were important in European mythology, including especially focusing on Artemis, whose name means bear, and who gradually loses a lot of those animalistic qualities as Greek myth approaches the modern era. In a sidebar page, I'll show it here. Demeter and Artemis, the bear goddesses. In the Bronze Age twilight of Neolithic religions, as many of the old animal divinities faded in popularity, the rich figure of the legendary bear spread itself across the conclave of the Mediterranean gods. Among these, the Greek goddess Demeter was the most important. Literally, Demeter means the grain of the bear mother, that is, barley mother. Older than Artemis, she was sometimes spoken of as Artemis' mother. Demeter was called the broad-faced one, and by Euripides, the mountain-ranging mother of the gods. As a form of Rhea, she turned the spindle of the celestial universe, its energy focused nightly in the master figure of the great bear. Demeter was also a form of Gaia, a great goddess of the lower world, a supreme Chthonian power of the Greek cosmos. Demeter's underworld associations are multifold. She was the nurse of Trophonios, the cave-dwelling oracle and master of initiation rites. A temple in her honor stood in the grove of Trophonios at Lebedea. Demeter's ceremonies at Phigaleia and elsewhere took place in a cavern, sometimes referred to as an underground sleeping room or sanctuary. The myth of her descent into and return from the underworld precedes the tales of later Olympian heroes who embodied dramatic elaborations of the metaphors of rebirth. Among the most famous Greek ceremonies, the Eleusinian Mysteries, performed at Eleusis, which means a place of birth, were Demeter's rites. They were celebrated with a barley water, mint drink, kaikem, and a torchlight parade, reflecting on Earth the seasonal march of stars across the heavens. As the mistress of renewal, Demeter came in time to oversee fruition in agriculture, but her origins there were no farms, only, says Lewis Farnell, the shadowy form of an aboriginal earth spirit. And so it continues for a while, but goes into some description there and then approaches more modern literature, which is the chapter The Literary Bear, discussing their use in modern literature, including, like I said at the start, the Kalevala. It also brings up a more noteworthy side of things. In English folklore is King Arthur. King Arthur is derived in his name from the bear, Arturos, which is the Latinized form of his name. It recalls the Celtic and the Greek word for bear. And so Arthur becomes the king. His association with royalty brings forward the idea of bear as royalty. The authors go into detail about these literary connections to the bear and how the human side of things interacted with that very natural large animal. She also discusses how a lot of fairy tales, you know, folklore, discuss bears, such as Goldilocks and the Three Bears, or a couple other ones, Snow White and Rose Red. Their mother, a poor widow, invites the bear inside to warm himself by the fire and urges her daughters not to fear the huge animal. The bear stays the winter, sleeping in the house each night in a kind of domestic hibernation and leaving each day in search of food. As it turns out, this bear changes into a prince and explains to the astonished Snow White and Rose Red that the dwarf had placed him under a magic spell that prevented him from ever becoming a prince until his spellbinder had died. Unwittingly, the two sisters have saved the prince. Despite the dwarf's unkindly treatment of them, the two girls willingly helped him out of trouble. They clearly personify absolute, unconditional love, the force of which ultimately makes possible the transformation of the bear/prince. As the story's tidy conclusion, Snow White marries the prince, and Rose Red marries the prince's brother, putting into practice the poor widow's advice to her two daughters, what one has, she must share with the other. And so there's all sorts of references that I honestly never knew when reading this book, and how much the bear as a creature has influenced humanity. So I picked this up used. I don't remember where exactly. And honestly, I don't think it matters too much where I bought it. I bought it used, and that means almost certainly $6, which is the half the cover price. On the back cover, I see cover design by David Stanford and Paul Buckley. Skeleton of cave bear from the American Museum of Natural History. Teddy Bears, courtesy of North American Bear Co. Incorporated. Photograph, copyright Joe Sachs. So, yeah, it's a interesting book. If you want a relatively short book, it's only 212 pages of content. It's a good way to learn about bears and how much being around them has influenced human history, human myth, human literature. So I really like this, and I think if you have loved the kind of nature stories that I've talked about, Tracks in the Sand, The Beast in the Garden, all sorts of other ones, the ones about wolves, the ones about mountain lions. You're going to like this as well, the one about the bears. So, yeah, my name is Wild Stag, and thank you for tuning in to another Used Book Rant.